Hello, welcome to another edition of the Pace Report, reporting live here at the David Rubenstein Atrium here at Lincoln Center here in New York City. In the first part of my exclusive interview with Mr. Al Bell and director Melvin Van Peebles was the importance of how Stax Records help promote and market black motion pictures as well as the soundtracks with Earth, Wind & Fire and Isaac Hayes. Tonight, Mr. Bell and I are going to sit down and talk about the political and social causes that the record label stood for, and also the witch hunt that Mr. Bell went through towards the very end of and the dark days of Stax Records.
Went and got with Charlie Bluehorn and Jim Jettleson at Gulf and Western Industries, who owned Famous Music, Dot Records, Paramount Pictures, and all of that. And he persuaded Bluehorn to make a stock deal with Stax, buy it, and give me enough money to have some operating expenses. And I boldly announced to the industry, we're going to release in a few months 28 hours. And they said, like we titled that Richard Pryor album, that nigga's crazy. In a few months, to make a long story short, we had 27 albums complete. In that group of albums is one called Hot Buttered Soul by Isaac Hayes and the Staple Singers with I'll Take You There and on and on and on. We brought our distributors into Memphis, Tennessee, and on a weekend, 25 distributors and Paramount helped us put together a great presentation. We did, somewhere around $4 million worth of business. And that is history. So you took that company that was zero at that point in time in 1968, and in 1975, Price Waterhouse valued those masters that we had produced from 1968 until mid-1975 at $67 million. And that's what that independent company did.
I'm a social science marketer. And the first thing I do is I observe from an entertainment standpoint what it is that artists do in their performances that entertains people and get the reaction from people, particularly females, to see the female reaction. And I had seen Isaac Hayes go into clubs and play by the time I get to Phoenix, and he'd do his rapping. And he might play for 30 minutes because he'd be rapping to the girls in the club and walk on by and rapping. And by the time he finished his set, Isaac would leave the club with two or three girls. And I said, you know, this is really working with him. I need to be able to capture that on record. And that's what led me to going into getting those songs recorded on Isaac. What we did was, though, because we ended up with only four songs, the longest, the lead song, being 18 minutes and 40 seconds, I knew we had to have something unique and different in order to get any kind of exposure or attention in the marketplace, because if you had a song that was over 2 minutes and 30 seconds long, you couldn't get it played on radio. Well, my song was 18 minutes and 40 seconds long. So what I did was, after I got the arrangement down and Isaac rapping and all of that, I flew to Detroit and got with two of Detroit's Motown's top arrangers, Dale Warren, I can't think of the other gentleman's name now, and told them that we had something unique here with Isaac, him rapping. I said, that's a combination of a pimp and a preacher in terms of how he's coming across from a cultural standpoint. I said, so I want you all to listen to his rap, what he's saying, listen to how he's singing, listen to what all of the musicians are doing, and in your mind, envision that as a motion picture. See that sound as a motion picture, and then take the Detroit Philharmonic Orchestra and write me a soundtrack to that motion picture. In other words, write me a soundtrack with the violins and the cellos and the oboes and what have you that enhance, embellish that motion picture that you hear vocally from Isaac rapping and what the musicians were playing. And Dale Warren and Johnny Allen were the two names. And they, after a lot of discussion with me, successfully accomplished that. And I got Pat Lewis in to do the background voices. We got the background voices and had something that was unique and different and put us in a position where we first started selling, for the first time, volume albums on an African-American artist. The industry said not only that African-Americans couldn't sell music in volume, but that they couldn't sell albums at all. Well, this was a thematic album titled Hot Buttered Soul, and I had to spend a lot of time to come up with that title, but it adequately described what I wanted to call it. And I'll tell you, I didn't know what to call it, but I knew I needed a title that would separate it out from everything else and get attention. And I spent, during that period of time, a month, the month of December in Jamaica, and I'd spent the month in Jamaica wrestling with what was I going to title this album. And on my way out, as I got on the plane in Montego Bay, sat down and I opened up the magazine, the centerfold in had an ad that said, Hot Buttered Rum. And I said, Hot Buttered Rum? And I just drew my finger through the rum and printed above it with my finger, Soul, Hot Buttered Soul. I said, that's what this is. And I named it Hot Buttered Soul, which would make it something different and something to be talked about.
But what I wanted to do was to help get rid of some of the fear that's been on us since slavery. And that was, when two or more of us are together, it's going to be a problem. To a police man, two more black people together, that'd be a major problem.
You remember who ran security?
Not only that, we had a security force and team that he managed, and not one gun, 112,000 black people in that Coliseum that day. But the idea was to show the world, give the world an insight into us, because we expressed our lives, our lifestyle, and our living through our songs.
Well, it was the largest gathering of African Americans, with the exception of Dr. King's march on Washington. This was before the Million Man March. We had 112,000 people that we caused to join us in the Los Angeles Coliseum. And what gave rise to it was, after the so-called Watts riots, which I think I've forced them now to classify them as Watts rebellion, because people were rebelling, being oppressed. But I went out and talked to my vice president of West Coast operations, Forrest Hamilton, said, you know, there's a gentleman here by the name of Tommy Jaquette, who's putting on the Watts Summer Festival, where people get a chance to come out and in the parades. They do something positive. They come out and display all kinds of cultural things and sell art, etc. And he said, I think that in order to begin to penetrate Los Angeles and get some presence, because we couldn't get played and our artists accepted in Hollywood, that perhaps if we did something with the Watts Summer Festival, that we'd get some attention here, and maybe that would give more attention to the artist and cause us to secure more radio airplay. So I said, okay, good idea. we talked over and over and over, and it evolved. It evolved from just that small festival to what became an event that I wanted to put on in the Los Angeles Coliseum, and then an event that I wanted to film. I decided that fortunately we had the money to do it, and I didn't have to ask anybody or debate with anybody about whether it made sense or not. We hired Awopa Productions, who was the finest documentary producer at that time, and David Awopa brought in Mel Stewart, who was a great director who had been directing all of the undersea projects, documentary projects that Awopa had been doing that were successful at that time. And I decided we're going to take our entire roster and go into the Los Angeles Coliseum and put on this Watch Stax event.
But in a few months, to make a long story short, we had 27 albums complete. In that group of albums was one called Hot Buttered Soul by the Cadres and the Staple Singers with I'll Take You There, and on and on and on. We brought our distributors into Memphis, Tennessee, and on a weekend, 25 distributors and Paramount helped us put together a great presentation. We did, somewhere around $4 million worth of business, and that is history. So you took that company that was zero at that point in time in 1968, and in 1975, Price Waterhouse valued those masters that we had produced from 1968 until mid-1975 at $67 million. And that's what that independent company did.
The beginning of them overthrowing Stax and destroying it started when and after I had made a deal with CBS with Clive Davis, which was a novel deal, had never been done before in the history of the industry, and it would have been, in my judgment and his judgment, a great business arrangement, great for the industry. I would have remained independent with Stax and would have sold product to CBS branch distribution in the same manner as I sold my wholesale distributors. The essence of our business relationship was that Clive wanted to get into the black market and reach the black market. I wanted to get to the white market. When I say get to the white market, meaning I wanted to get to the point where I could get my product positioned in Woolworth, Crest, Sears, and those type stores, and I couldn't get it done at that point in time. Well, CBS had the clout to cause that to happen. Clive wanted to build on the black side. He had signed Gamble and Huff and was talking to other black artists, but his problem was he couldn't penetrate the retailers that sold the black product. Well, I had the catalog that would allow his salespeople to walk right through the door. And that's how we were able to make the kind of deal we made. It was a matter of matching needs. And not too long after that, Clive got fired for whatever the reasons were, which I questioned. And the relation, the deal that Clive and I had made, which was unusual, had not permeated the hierarchy of CBS, and they didn't understand it. That was a problem. I mean, it should have been a 12% deal, and not you selling us, and you being independent, and you manufacturing, and you marketing and promoting. And no, we don't do that. We're the big fish, you're the little fish, and it doesn't work that way. And they set out to put me in my position after offering me, some incentives that would have allowed me to front off the company and paint me up as a very important black man in America, which I resisted because I would have been tantamount to a Judas.
That'll do it again for another edition of the Pace Report, reporting live here at the David Rubenstein Atrium here at Lincoln Center here in New York City. I'd like to personally thank Mr. Al Bell for his time and his graciousness, as well as the staff and management here at Lincoln Center and the Out of Doors series. As always, please visit my website, www.thepacereport.com, for my weekly column as well as my past segments. Until next time, remember, if it's in the groove, it'll make you move. Until next time, peace.